Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Basement Electronics. So anyone who hasn't been following along, I've been doing daily streams of this electronics advent calendar. And I've done day one was a recording. Days 2 to 5 were live streams. But due to personal commitments, day 6 and day 7 is going to be recorded. I am going to be releasing days 2 to 5 as a compilation video, but you'll be able to watch all this, including the streams, from a playlist, which is down in the description and also a card up in the top right corner. In yesterday's stream, we built a 4-position slot machine, which essentially is a binary counter, and the whole purpose was to try to push the button and stop it at a point where all 4 lights are turned off. Ooh, all 4 were on. But today is day 6. And today's game is called Wire Maze. So let's start by opening up today's little window to see what parts they've given us. So, looks like we're getting a larger packet of stuff. So we are getting a speaker. And that's it. Behind today's door, there's a piezo sound converter, which we'll use as a small loudspeaker to emit sounds for the well-known wire maze game of steady-handed skills. The objective is to guide a wire loop along a bent wire without the two touching. Whenever the loop touches a long wire, an alert is sounded, thus signaling that the player is lost. However, if you manage to touch the target contact at the end without touching the hot wire, a victory sound is heard. In order to play this game, you have to start a new program. Therefore, pin 8 of the microcontroller, so right here, is no longer connected to ground, but via a resistor to VCC. To prepare the game, cut a wire of approximately 30 centimeters in length and completely remove its insulation. This is the wire that you have to follow without touching. A second wire, approximately 5 centimeters long, also with the insulation completely removed, serves as the end contact. The loop is made from a third wire, approximately 15 centimeters in length. Here, you only have to remove the insulation from the ends. However, at one end, you have to strip it off at a suitable length to form a loop. The size of the loop and the shape into which you bend the hot wire will determine the difficulty of the game. And we'll take a look at the blue info box later. So looking at the yesterday's circuit to today's diagram, we are not going to need the LEDs. That's actually a little warm. I should get a container for those. The switch is going to be moving, so we'll take that out. Okay, so the 3 resistors and 3 capacitors all stay the same. That stays. That wire stays, which goes to pin 9. But that wire is removed. And this wire is removed, which is our pin 8 and pin 7, or 6. Okay, so our switch goes up here. And our speaker the positive goes to pin 1. your negative goes down to the negative bar. So all we have to do is our three loops. So I think this is our completion loop. This is our live loop. Then this here is our wand. So it wants the live loop and the completion loop to be completely stripped. I don't know if I want to do that. Or at least not on the completion loop. For the completion loop, it should be enough just to have the end down here stripped. Turn it on. And if we touch. So if we touch the loop, we get that beep. Yes, I'm cheating. And if you get to the end, you get the low tone. So, unfortunately, this wire isn't very flexible. So, actually getting it all the way around. It's kind of difficult. But I think we made our point. In the blue box, while most of the microcontroller pins serve as outputs for attaching the LEDs in the loudspeaker, some of them are inputs, in this case pins 5 and 6. Internally, they are each connected to a VC, connected to power via a resistor. When the microcontroller reads the state of these inputs, it usually sees a high voltage, i.e. state 1. However, when the connection to ground is closed by the wires or a push button, the controller sees state 0 and turns on the appropriate sound. In some of the following games, we'll use two further input pins at pins 3 and 4 of the controller. Additionally, there are two analog inputs at pins 7 and 8. Here, the controller can not only differentiate it between on and off, but actually measure voltage. So that gives us, we've been trying to get an idea about the inner workings of this microcontroller. Now, the one thing I don't quite understand, they say pins 3 and 4 are inputs, but we had LEDs on there for the last two games. So it was acting as output. So I'm still not entirely sure how this microcontroller is working. At any rate, I think that about does it for day 6. I hope you found this interesting, if not informative. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much. Goodbye.